of the temple.
1, 2.
Okay? How many of you think this is a trick question? Okay. The correct answer is that was not what was in the ark in the temple. That's what was in the ark in the tabernacle. When you look in this portion, in fact, our Haftarah portion tells you what was in there. The only thing that was in the temple were the stone tablets, the Ten Commandments. Now, we don't know what happened to the other things, but here's something that I believe. When the ark was taken from the Israelites, the glory of God basically left. I believe that it was the glory of God that was keeping the manna, and the rod that budded from doing what nature naturally does. What would happen to bread if you left it for, oh, say, 300 years or so? And what would happen to the rod? It would disintegrate. It would rot. The same way that God preserved the people's clothing during the 40 years in the desert is the same way that God preserved the manna in the ark and the rod that budded. I believe that when they got the rod, when they got the ark back from the Philistines, that stuff had just long been disintegrated. It had long been gone. So the only thing they had when they brought it in to bring it into the temple was the stone tablets, because that won't disintegrate. So anyway, that was the trick question. But when we look at the temple, it was all based on the tabernacle. So there were three things in the ark, in the tabernacle that we need to talk about. The rod, the manna, and the stone tablets. Okay, let's take a look first at the rod of Aaron. The rod of Aaron in Numbers chapter 17. Remember the story? It's really a neat story. Moses was constantly being challenged by the people. In this case, Aaron was being challenged also because he had been named the high priest. The people said, hey, and I'm paraphrasing, hey, what's up with that? We should be the high priest too. And so God said, all right, fine. You want to do that? Let's do this. Let's play a game. The leaders of each of the tribes of Israel, y'all bring your rods. Aaron will bring his rod, and we'll take those rods, all of them, and we'll put them into the holy place. Whichever rod buds the following morning, he's the one I've chosen. You're like, okay, fine, let's play. So they all toss in their rods, and in the morning, Aaron's rod buds. But it doesn't just bud. It buds, it blooms, and it flowers. Now, this was an almond tree, and we've talked about this. It takes many, many years for an almond tree to bear fruit, okay? Not overnight, but that's exactly what happened. Overnight, it budded, it bloomed, in a flower, which meant it produced fruit. That's the rod that's here in this particular ark in the tabernacle. And what it signified was the identity of the priest. Don't miss this, okay? If the ark is a representation of our hearts, and inside our heart, our ark, is the rod of Aaron that budded, means that deep within us, in our hearts, is an identity. An identity as priest. Now, we know that the scripture talks about this. Because it says in the scriptures, in the New Covenant portions, in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, it says that we are a royal priesthood. So that's not contrary to scripture. In fact, it's part of who we are as New Testament believers. And then the people back then would have understood this. This is what's in the ark. This is who we are. What did priests do? What was the job of the priest? The number one job of the priest. Remember, whatever you identify as the number one job of the priest ends up being your job. So what is the number one job of the priest? Don't make it up. Think about it from the scripture. The number one job of the priest. This is the job description. Exodus chapter 28, verse 1 says that the number one job of the priest is to minister to God. To minister to God. It's not to minister to people, although when you minister to people, you minister to God. Why? Yeshua said it himself. What you do for the least of these, you do for me. I'm going to show you the first of a couple of video clips, little illustrations. The video clips that I show are always meant to be illustrations. And the first clip is from Les Miserables, not the most recent one, but the one with Liam Neeson as Jean Valjean. This clip illustrates what it means when you minister to people, to minister to God. Let's watch.
Why did the ghost bother you? You didn't have to fly.
Close it down. I have to give you some drugs.
It's all right. I'll be no child. You deserve it. I don't understand why you're being so kind.
I was preoccupied. I didn't know. If you'd come straight to me, none of it. You need to rest.
You don't want a kiss.
I want you to rest. And don't worry. I'll bring the doctor to you.
Going to
the No, I can't. I sent the money to bring us out here.
She can't live with me.
Of course she can. She will. She'll attend the school and you won't have any more worries. When you're better, I'll find work for you.
But you don't understand. I'm a whore. And because it has the Father.
She has the Lord.
She has no father. She has the Lord. The Lord is her father. I will tell you, the heart of any parent will tell you, when you minister to my children, when you minister to my grandchildren, you have ministered to me. When my children are in need and somebody helps them, I feel a personal debt of gratitude. For that person has not just ministered to my child, but has ministered to me as well. This is exactly what Yeshua was saying, what Yeshua's father was saying through his son. When you've done to the least of these, you've done to me. What you do to me, you do to my Father, is really what he was saying. So when you minister to people who are the creation of God, in his image, you minister to him. It's not about ministering to people.